me, I've been spending a little bit of time in the book of Acts, in particular chapter 2, of late, and we may continue to do that in the weeks ahead as we really take a deep look at Holy Spirit and the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, in our lives, in the body of Christ. We're going to take a look at the early church this morning in Acts chapter 2, verse 40 through 47. I'm going to share some thoughts I've entitled Devoted. And if you were listening in children's moment, were you listening? Devoted means extremely loving and loyal. That's powerful, isn't it? When you get up in the mornings, if you do that in the mornings, maybe some other time of the day, and you do your daily devotion, have you ever thought that that is representative of your extreme love and loyalty to God? I'm going to make it a point and a practice to take a portion of my day and give it to God. I like to do it in the mornings. If I do not do it in the mornings and I wait till later in the day, lo and behold, something unexpected is going to come up later in the day and it's not going to happen. So I learned, like a lot of others, I should have listened to them a whole lot sooner. If you don't do it first thing in the morning, in my world, it may not get done. But you know, as I put in practice more and more rising earlier in the morning, and I will tell you, it's become easier as I've gotten older. I don't sleep as much as I used to. Easier for me to get up in the morning. I'll wake up and can't go back to sleep, and I'll think, hey, I'm going to spend some time with Jesus. And just get up and pray and get in the Word and start my day with Jesus. And I want to tell you, my life is much better for it. And if you don't do that, even if it's 15 minutes, find a way to give Jesus 15 minutes of your morning, of your day, and let Him know of your devotion. You see, a lot of times when we say devotion, we think that little upper room that we're using or some other book or guide is our devotion. We call them devotionals. Yes, we do. But it's not so much about what you're reading. It's about who you are and why you're reading. I am reading, I am praying, I am spending time with God early in the morning and throughout the day because I am devoted. I am extremely in love with and loyal to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And if for no other reason, because He is extremely loyal and loving toward us. And if you don't know that this morning, you have not gotten to know our Savior very well. I want to share with you Acts chapter 2, verse 40 through 47. This is the New Living Translation. Then Peter continued preaching for a long time. You see, I'm not so long-winded after all, am I? Strongly urging all his listeners, save yourselves from this crooked generation. Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. May God add His richest blessings to the reading of His Word. As we consider Luke's account of the formation of the early church, and Luke is the author of the book of Acts. He wrote the Gospel of Luke. He wrote the book of Acts. And sometimes we might think of Luke as being one of the original 12 disciples, but he was not. He was a contemporary of Paul's, and he journeyed and traveled with Paul, and he has gifted us, God has gifted us through Luke, that beloved physician as he's called, the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. So as we consider Luke's account of the formation of the early church, we really get to see God's heart's desire taking shape in visible form. Last Sunday, as we talked about holy hearts, we talked about it is God's heart's desire, both proclaimed by God in the Old Testament and quoted by the Apostle Paul in the New Testament in 2 Corinthians, that God's heart's desire is that He lives in us and walks among us, that He is our God and we are His people, and that He presents Himself to us to be embraced by us as the Heavenly Father, as we are sons and daughters of God. We begin to see that holy family, that spiritual family, take shape in Acts chapter 2. They begin to gather. They begin to do things together. A community is being formed. And it's all taking place because Holy Spirit is there. We have to know in the background that these are Spirit-filled people. I mean, we're talking about fresh off the day of Pentecost. And Holy Spirit is working wonderfully in the hearts and lives of these people, sharing in and through them God's plan of the formation of that early church. Now then, as we think about God's heart, God's mind, God's plan for the formation of the church and any other thing God's doing on the face of the earth, we remember a couple of things that Jesus just held very important in His heart and mind. And He spoke about these things. Number one was the great command. Somebody came to Jesus and said, "What's the greatest command?" And He asked him about some of the ten. And the guy said, "Oh, I've done them." You know, they were familiar. They knew. But as Jesus talked about the great command, He said, it's this: that you would love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. The second is likened to the first, and that you would love your neighbor as yourself. Love, the Bible says, John says, God is love. So love is at the foundation of all that God does. Even when God disciplines and chastises, it's because of His love for us. So something that is always present in the heart of Jesus, Holy Spirit, the Heavenly Father, is that great command. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. He's already pulling in relationship into the picture. And then we have the Great Commission, that we would go into all the world preaching the Gospels in all nations, making disciples everywhere, teaching them everything that Jesus has taught, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You see, Jesus has a love that He wants to share with the whole world. And the power of this love is so much so, it will radically change our lives. And you know what? You will have a love and a care for people you may not have known a year ago. But God will put them in your hearts and lives with that radical, extreme love of the Holy Spirit in you, and you'll love and you'll build relationship with people that you may have thought you never would love or build relationship with. So that great command and that great commission is being fulfilled in the early church by Spirit-filled people. Let me read to you one of my favorite verses about love in the New Testament. Romans 5:5, and this is the last part of that verse. The love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. So, if you call yourself or consider yourself to be a Spirit-filled Christian, then it should be evident in your heart and life that the love of God has been poured out inside of you. So much so that you have a hard time containing it. Have you ever gotten tickled in church when you weren't supposed to laugh? Like right now, you know? I remember one time as a child, me and my best friend on Sunday evening was sitting side by side in the pew. And I was not sitting by my parents, but I was sitting close to my parents. And they had taught me how to behave in church. And we were sitting there and we were singing. We like to sing. And I'm probably 12 years old. And we have the hymnals out and we're singing with the congregation. And he kind of bumps me with his elbow. And I looked at him and he kind of nodded his head to right in front of us. And I looked up and I thought, I don't get what he's pointing at. And he nodded his head again. And then I stopped and I looked at the gentleman sitting in front of us. And on the back of his head stood a twig straight up. Just like alfalfa off the Little Rascals, if y'all used to watch Little Rascals. And as he sang, that twig bounced, and oh, I covered my mouth. I hid my face. I tried not to laugh out loud. And it started oozing out. And I thought, Mom's going to kill me. So I just got up and left the sanctuary. I went outside. I laughed real good, and I came back and sat down, and I didn't look up again. Because I thought, oh, no. But I couldn't help myself. And the whole point in saying that is when the love of God, the Spirit of God, is truly poured out in us, so much so, as God would have it, you can't contain what the Spirit of God will do in and through you, especially when it relates to love. So we're going to see how that love is unfolded in the daily life and experience of these early church people. You look at verse number 42 of what we read, and Luke describes the people like this. All the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper and to prayer. And as I said earlier, to be devoted is to be extremely loving and loyal. And as we look at the early church, we really see some extreme things taking place. And we're going to talk about that here in just a few moments. And we're going to see it in their daily lives. You may be a Spirit-filled believer if you're extremely loving and you are loyal to the apostles' teaching. We would call that the Word of God. You know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospels, the letters Paul wrote, Peter wrote, others wrote. We have this beautiful, wonderful collection of the apostles' teaching and the entire Word of God, anything that might have been said outside of their teaching opportunity and experience. And what did the apostles teach? They taught Jesus and a whole lot of Him. And the disciples in that early church were hungry for the Word of God. They were devoted to, they were loving and loyal toward the apostles' teaching. Hey, Peter, tell us that story again. Is there another parable that Jesus shared that might better give us some insight into the kingdom of God and how it operates in our hearts and lives? Now, would you tell me, Peter, one more time about when Jesus healed all of those sick people? I've got somebody down here I love, and we're going to be praying for them for physical healing, and we want them to be made whole, and we want our faith to be strong. And you know, as a matter of fact, Peter, now that we're talking about it, I remember Jesus talking about the last days and how our hearts and minds and lives need to be ready for the return of Christ. Could you tell us a little bit more about the return of Christ and what we need to do to be ready? I can just imagine the early church feasting upon the apostles' teaching. But you know what? It was not so readily available as it is to us today. Is there anybody in here that's had any trouble getting their hands on a Bible? If you have, I can point you to many on the internet, and we've got a stack we can give you. But you know, they counted it an honor, a joy, an opportunity to hear the apostles talk about Jesus, to teach and preach about Jesus. And they were devoted not just to hearing, but to putting into practice what they heard. And you know, part of that was out of God's love for the world, John 3:16, to take that good news of Jesus Christ to the whole world. That's what Jesus told them in Acts chapter 1. He said, you're going to be endued with power from on high. You're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the utmost parts of the world. Take that message of love and forgiveness and grace and relationship to the world. And they heard that message as they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. And I don't know about you, but you know, if I'm excited about something, I want to talk to somebody about it. I want to share with somebody what I've learned, what kind of insights God has given me about the Word. And I want to hear from you what your insights are. I love small groups and Bible studies where we can have conversation with each other. I learned a lot from more of a lecture style. That's a good thing too. But I love just to sit down with a group of Christians and just talk about Jesus for a little while. What my experience has been, what I've learned, what you've learned. Hey, let's put it all together and have a bigger picture of who Jesus is. And fellowship gives us that opportunity. But I also like to just love people. I just like to get around people and laugh and smile and have a good time and just enjoy fellowship with you, relationship with you. I want to know what your joys are. And I want to know what your sorrows are, what your victories and your defeats are. I want to know what you're passionate about, how God has gifted you in life, and how you're seeing God work through that gifting. I want to know about your intimate relationship with Jesus Christ as we grow in relationship with each other. I love fellowship. When I was growing up, I was 16 to 17 years old. One Sunday night, a group of us, after worship on Sunday night, stopped by Jack's in Bowden, Georgia, and we ate some hamburgers and had some ice cream, and we talked and laughed for about an hour and a half. And I remember a young guy, he was almost my age, his name was Keith Whiten. He was probably 15, I was 16 or 17, and he looked at me and said, "I didn't know Christians could have this much fun. I want to do this again." And I tell people, you can have fun at church, just call it fellowship. Okay, that's the secret of the church. You can have fun, just call it fellowship. I was reading the newsletter from Fraser Memorial in Montgomery, and they had an ice cream social. They had a hymn singing, and then they had ice cream afterwards. And I thought, how much fun that would be. Just don't let your ice cream melt. It would be a great time in the Lord. They had fellowship with one another, and the community saw that taking place. It was yet a fulfillment of Jesus' words in John 13 when he said to his disciples, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another." He didn't say if you're great preachers, great teachers, give richly to the kingdom of God. He said, the world will know you're my disciples by how you love each other. And when you love each other with the love of Christ, the world must take note, and they will. That's the power of the fellowship of the body of Christ. And I am not opposed to eating while we have fellowship. I'm just not opposed. And you know, you can have a great time sitting around a table sharing a meal. It's an intimate place, it really is. And you know, you don't just invite everybody to come to your house and eat dinner. Have you ever thought about that? But Jesus, when he talked about the great feast, he said, go out and invite everybody. See, Jesus wants everybody at his table to share with him in the most intimate things in life, including the Lord's Supper. And what a beautiful thing it is that we have the honor and the joy of gathering here at these altars on First Sunday and then in the chapel on other Sundays and share in Holy Communion. We call it a sacrament, which means it's a means of grace, an avenue by which the grace of God is poured afresh into our hearts and lives, as the Spirit of God is poured afresh and anew into our hearts and lives. And it's a beautiful, wonderful thing that we experience Holy Communion, fellowship with God in that moment. But it's also beautiful, maybe not for you, but for me, to stand up here and watch you come down as groups and watch different families kneel down together at the altar, representative of the family, of the body of Christ. And I look at that and it puts a smile on my heart. When I see the spiritual family down here in fellowship, in communion, with one of the most glorious, powerful things we could do on the face of the earth, and that is Holy Communion. Not just communion, but Holy Communion. And I want to tell you, it doesn't hurt my feelings at all when I see God's people pray. They were devoted to prayer, which meant they had extreme love for and loyalty to prayer. I did a word search for prayer in the book of Acts, New King James Version. It is mentioned by name 30 times in the 26, 28 chapters of the book. So in some chapters, it's mentioned more than once. But that lets you know what a vital part of the life of the early church prayer was, and what a vital part prayer must be in the life of the church today. And these are just a few of the signs of a Spirit-filled church. And then after Luke points those four things out, in a few verses, he just gives us a very general picture of what that looks like in daily life. In verse number 43, he says, a deep sense of awe or godly fear came over them all. If God doesn't change my heart and mind, next Sunday we're going to talk about the fear of God. When's the last time you heard a sermon on the fear of God? I don't know if I've ever preached one, but God put that on my heart several days ago, and it's on the train to Gunnersville First United Methodist Church. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. Where the Holy Spirit is working powerfully to the point that there are signs and wonders, there's awe. When God came down on the mountain in Exodus 19 and 20, revealing Himself in some measure to the Israelites, oh, they were afraid. They had the fear of God. There's a point and a purpose and a reason for that. All the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day. We need to start having church 7 days a week. Amen? I barely got one amen. And I really didn't expect to get one. You know, because we don't just worship together at church. We ought to be worshiping at home in our devotion time. Yes, amen. There you go. You're set free. Met in homes for the Lord's Supper, shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. I mean, they were living the life, and other people were looking in and said, I want some of what they have. I want some of what they have. And God added to the church daily those who were being saved. You may read through that last chapter or the last set of verses and go, wow, that's extreme. They sold their possessions and gave it to the church to feed the poor. Absolutely. That's what you see, I believe, in chapter 5 when Ananias and Sapphira had an extra piece of land they didn't need. So they sold it and they brought the money to the church. Well, they did something wrong. They held back part of the proceeds and lied about it, so they both died in their tracks. Maybe that'll tell you something about the fear of the Lord. Don't lie to the Holy Spirit. But they did. They had extra stuff that they didn't need. Do you have any extra stuff you don't need? Or how much extra stuff do you have that you don't need? They sold it, and they brought the money, and they said, go feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and things like that. We look at this, we might say, wow, that's extreme. Yes, we are to be extremely loyal and loving. That's what it is to be devoted. That's the kind of church Holy Spirit creates. And then we wonder, what could make this happen? Wouldn't it be wonderful if we pressed deeper into this? Because we're a loving church. We're a generous church. But what if we pressed in deeper? What would make that happen? The same thing that made it happen here. The Holy Spirit of God. Having the freedom to actively work in the hearts and lives of the people of the church. Our task today is to examine the Scriptures. But let me encourage you, church, as you examine Scripture, we must also allow Scripture to examine us. Let that word examine you as you consider that the early church was devoted, extremely loving and loyal to the apostles' teaching, fellowship, sharing meals, prayer. Let it examine your heart and life and see if that's me. If it's not, we have room for improvement. If the world were to look upon us, Would the world see our extreme love and loyalty to God? Would the world call us devoted? I pray that it would, to God's glory and our blessing. Amen? Amen. We have another song to share, congregational hymn, Sweet Hour of Prayer. Please know these altars are open. If you would like to come this morning for prayer, please come. If I can pray with you about anything, I would love to do that. Stand with us as we sing.